is very much at home in the Asian Institute of Management. As mentioned to the professor, I was a professor here for 4 years before I became a member of the House of Representatives. I was asked to talk about the West European Sea situation, the major national security and economic concern. And I think you're all very familiar with this picture. This is the picture of the South China Sea, the so-called the red line, this is the so-called nine dash line, and the blue lines are the lines of the exclusive economic zone of the various coastal states in the South China Sea. And you will see that the nine dash line encroaches into the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines, from Brunei, Malaysia, even Indonesia, as well as Vietnam. And that's the reason why we have so much problem. And this is a picture of the various claims in the South China Sea. Another picture. And you can see from the flags what are the countries that occupy the various features within the South China Sea. And this is the nine dash line in detail. And just about a month ago, China announced the 10 dash line. But in my opinion, it doesn't affect the Philippines because the additional dash is to the east of Taiwan and does not intrude into our exclusive economic zone. And this is a comparison of the 9 dash line and the 10 dash line. I'm familiar with the Spratt list because as a new graduate of the Naval Academy in 1971, I was part of a secret mission that transported troops, weapons, equipment, and supplies to the islands we occupied in Freedom Land, that was the name before, now called Kalayaan Island Group. I'll show you a map drawn by Italian Vincenzo Coronelli in 1690. And you can see that there is no reference to the China Sea or Mare di Chen. There was a Mare del Indi, but no reference to China. Another map of the Philippines by Pedro Murillo Velarde in 1744. And you can see the Scarborough Shoal, then called Panakot, off by the province of Zambales, clearly shown as part of the Philippines as early as 1744. The exclusive economic zone, this is contained in UNCLOS, defined as an area beyond and adjacent to the territorial sea, subject to the legal regime established in UNCLOS. And this is, of course, within the 200-mile exclusive economic zone. And under Article 56, the economic zone, the coastal state, in this particular case, the Philippines, has sovereign rights for the purpose of exploring and exploiting, conserving and managing the natural resources, whether living or non-living, of the waters superjacent to the seabed and of the seabed and its subsoil. Jurisdiction as provided for in the relevant provision of the UNCLOS with regard to the establishment and use of artificial islands, installations and structures, marine scientific research, protection and preservation of the marine environment. Now, let's talk about the mischief reef in 1994. In 1994, the PRC, People's Republic of China, built the initial structures on stilts here when the Philippine Navy was not patrolling the area due to a monsoon season. Since the reef is just 130 nautical miles away from Palawan, well inside the Philippines EEZ, the Philippines immediately protested this action. However, China rejected the protest and stressed that the structures were sheltered for fishermen. And this was the structure during that time. In 1999, China added more structures to Mischief Reef, which transformed the place into a military installation instead of shelters for fishermen. And this is how it looks close up. Now let's talk of Scarborough Shoal or Bajo de Masinloc. On April 8, 2012, a Philippine Navy surveillance plane spotted 8 Chinese fishing vessels docked at the waters of Scarborough Shoal. BRP Del Pilar was sent on the same day by the Philippine Navy to survey the vicinity of the shoal and confirm the presence of the fishing vessels and their ongoing activities. On April 10, 2012, BRP Del Pilar came to inspect the accounts of the fishing vessels. The Philippine inspection team discovered illegally collected corals, giant clams, and live sharks inside the first vessel boarded by the team. BRP Del Pilar reported that they attempted to arrest the Chinese fishermen but were blocked by Chinese maritime surveillance ships. By July 2012, China had erected a barrier to the entrance of the shore, and vessels belonging to the China Marine Surveillance and Fisheries Law Enforcement Command were observed in the nearby disputed shore. Since then, the Chinese government vessels have been turning away Filipino vessels sailing to the area. This is a bird's eye view of Scarborough Shore. Almost 14 years ago, in December 1999, I delivered a privileged speech on Bajo de Masinloc for Scarborough Shore and made the following observations, and I quote my speech in 1999. Why would a military behemoth and an emerging economic power such as China be so preoccupied with microscopic Scarborough Shoal, which rightly belongs to us in the first place? When U.S. naval forces were still occupying Subic, the area was used for naval gunfire target practice by the U.S. Navy. China did not even make a whimper. Obviously, the reason was that the U.S. Navy was too big to handle. No less than UNCLOS sealed off our territorial jurisdiction on Scarborough Shoal, which is situated well within the 200-mile exclusive economic zone. The answer, and I continued in my speech, the answer, Mr. Speaker, is military posture. The Scarborough Shoal is part of China's military projection at the South China Sea. In Scarborough Shoal, China has found a perfect forward fortress at the east to back up its slow but non-stop political and naval march towards the north, where there are Korea, Japan, Taiwan, among others. China's unleashed a blob at the South China Sea, floating eastward, growing slowly, menacingly, nearly unopposed, devouring every speck, every shoal and reef along the way. Chinese military contingents are already positioned in various reefs, islands, and rocks of the South China Sea, particularly in the Spratlys and the Paracels. The Scarborough Shoal is just one more step forward in the bid to secure full control of the world's second busiest international sea lane. And I concluded with this warning, Mr. Speaker, and this was in 1999, it is apparent from the foregoing that what the Philippines is facing is not a gentle, lovable Chinese panda, but a fire-breathing, highly awakened Chinese dragon. It is a delicate, complex, and crucial policy issue that we must resolve for the sake of the next generation. To me, it is a security threat that could overshadow all threats that we face in the century that is about to end, and that was in 1999. And I talked also about the importance, the economic importance of the South China Sea, such as, for example, that it has 3 times more traffic volume than the Suez Canal, 5 times more traffic volume than the Panama Canal, that there are reported 25 billion cubic meters of natural gas, 105 billion barrels of oil, and 91 billion barrels of oil in the James Shoal. And then, finally, I mentioned, last March, and this was again in 1999, buckling under pressure to stop increasing its presence in the Spratlys, China sent its foreign assistant minister, Wang Yi, to this country. This was the first diplomatic act it initiated since 1995, when Filipino fishermen discovered Chinese installations at the Mischief Reef. That meeting, however, only demonstrated further China's resolve to keep the Spratlys for itself. Wang Yi later admitted that they cannot share the facilities constructed in Mischief Reef. Today, the incumbent foreign minister of China is the same Wang Yi who, as assistant minister in 1995, took a hard position on China's land grab of Mischief Reef in 1995. Here's an aerial photo of our shore. It is not small. Its area of around 150 square kilometers makes the shore as big as Quezon City, or around 3 times the area of Parañaque. China, with its resources and engineering capability, can easily convert our shore into a big naval installation. Around this perimeter alone, more than 100 DDGs, or guided missile destroyers, can be berthed. Inside the 49 feet deep lagoon more than 200 DDGs can be anchored. It destroys a draft of around 31 feet. It is my considered opinion that China intends to convert our shore into a naval station the same way they did to the much smaller Mystic Reef. This is the danger that faces us within this decade. A Chinese naval installation in Scarborough Shoal or Bajo de Masinloc will be a grave threat to the security of the Philippines and our allies. It is going to be like a dagger pointed at the heartland of the country. One headline on July 27, 2013, China transforms reef into a naval station, referring to Mischief Reef. But that's old news, because China transformed Mischief Reef into their military installation within our EEC as early as in 1999. Now let's look at the South China Sea in relation to most of the Asia-Pacific area to appreciate that this situation cannot be addressed in isolation. That is, other geopolitical factors inevitably must come into play. And I show you this map. There is Korea, there is Japan, of course there's China, the Philippines, Vietnam, Indonesia, Malaysia, and of course giant India. There's the Bay of Bengal, there's the Arabian Sea, and there's Indian Ocean. Unfortunately, Australia is not shown in this map. The preceding map shows that the South China Sea links the Indian Ocean to the vast Pacific Ocean. It is a choke point. The power that controls the South China Sea can control the economy of major economic powers like China, Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, and the Philippines, which is now considered an emerging economic power. India must pass through the South China Sea to interact with China, Vietnam, the Philippines, Korea, Taiwan, and Japan. This may come as a shock to many, but students of sea power strategist Alfred Thayer Mahan know this. China suffers from a very vulnerable geography. For years in talk shows and speeches, I have been saying this. China is surrounded in all directions and has a short coastline compared to its landmass and population. China's naval assets have very restricted maneuvering space, unlike those of India, Japan, Indonesia, even the Philippines, and of course, the United States. China's sea lines of communications, or SLOCs, are very vulnerable. Sea lines of communication, or SLOC, is a term describing the primary maritime routes between ports used for trade, logistics, and naval forces. It is generally used in reference to naval operations to ensure that SLOCs are open, or in times of war, as a hostile act, to close them. India's Navy can blockade China's trade passing through the Indian Ocean. A small but deadly naval force based in Singapore can paralyze China's seabound trade west of the South China Sea. Vietnamese submarines can wreak havoc on China's merchant marine and even the PLA Navy. A small squadron of Australian submarines positioned in the southern periphery of the South China Sea can stop China's seaborne trade. To the east, China can be blocked by Japan, which is a potent navy and air force considered among the most modern and powerful in the world. And even the Philippines, with a modest investment in military upgrading, can interdict the Palawan Passage with a swarm of small guided missile boats and an array of medium-range, land-based, mobile missiles hidden in the passages of Palawan, Mindoro, and Luzon. I have been talking about that for years. Last August 2013, the Australia's Strategy Policy Institute came out with this article, China's Maritime Dilemmas. The strategy behind China's emerging naval capability is subject to considerable debate. Most of the commentary concentrates on the People's Liberation Army Navy, or PLAN, capability development. Some commentators argue that the PLAN has shifted its focus towards developing a blue water navy to contest America's maritime predominance in the Western Pacific. But the plan also continues to invest in defensive anti-access area denial, A2AD, for operations in its first island chain. The common theme of this assessment is that China's growing naval power should have us worrying, talking of the allies. However, while the PLAN's growing maritime capabilities potentially pose a challenge, to the United States and countries in the